Welcome to our worship on this 12th Sunday after Pentecost. Glad you're all here with us. I just wanted to mention that I've gotten emails over the last couple of weeks from people who are watching our YouTube services from upstate New York, from Iowa, from Florida, from Japan. So, hello, wherever you are out there in the YouTube universe watching our services, we're glad you're with us, and we hope that you're blessed by our worship services, and we hope that you're all keeping safe and healthy. So let's begin our worship in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins to God our Father, imploring him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Upon this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the word, announce the grace of God to all of you, and in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, whom to know is everlasting life, grant us to know your Son Jesus to be the way, the truth, and the life, that we may boldly confess him to be the Christ and steadfastly walk in the way that leads to life eternal. Through the same Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Old Testament reading for the 12th Sunday after Pentecost is from Isaiah chapter 51. Listen to me, you who pursue righteousness, you who seek the Lord. Look to the rock from which you were hewn, and to the quarry from which you were dug. Look to Abraham your father, and to Sarah who bore you, for he was but one when I called him, that I might bless him and multiply him. For the Lord comforts Zion, he comforts all her waste places, and makes her wilderness like Eden, her desert like the garden of the Lord. Joy and gladness will be found in her, thanksgiving and the voice of song. Give attention to me, my people, and give ear to me, my nation, for a law will go out from me, and I will set my justice like a light to the peoples. My righteousness draws near, my salvation has gone out, and my arms will judge the peoples. The coastlands hope for me, and for my arm they wait. Lift up your eyes to the heavens, and look at the earth beneath, for the heavens vanish like smoke, the earth will wear out like a garment, and they who dwell in it will die in like manner. But my salvation will be forever, and my righteousness will never be dismayed. Here ends the reading. The epistle for today is from the 11th and 12th chapters of Romans. Paul writes these words. Oh, the depth of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God! How unsearchable are his judgments, and how inscrutable his ways! For who has known the mind of the Lord, or who has been his counselor? Or who has been a gift to him that he might be repaid? For from him, and through him, and to him are all things. To him be glory forever. Amen. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body we have many members, and the members do not all have the same function, so we, though many, are one body in Christ, and individually members one of another. Having gifts that differ according to the grace given to us, let us use them. If prophecy, in proportion to our faith, if service, in our serving, the one who teaches, in his teaching, the one who exhorts, in his exhortation, the one who contributes, in generosity, the one who leads, with zeal, the one who does acts of mercy, with cheerfulness. Here ends the reading. And then this is the Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 16th chapter. Now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon Barjona. For flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter. And on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." He strictly charged the disciples to tell no one that he was the Christ. This is the gospel of the Lord. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Our text for the message today is that gospel reading from the 16th chapter of Matthew. So the disciples have been with Jesus for over 2 years. From the very start of his ministry, it has been the Lord's desire that they come to know who he is and understand his mission. There were times when the disciples seemed to get who Jesus was. Early on, Nathanael declared Jesus the Son of God simply on the basis of Jesus telling him that he had seen him from a long way off. After Jesus' first miracle at the wedding at Cana in Galilee, his disciples believed in him. And seeing other miracles, such as the calming of the sea and Jesus walking on water, the disciples worshipped him, saying, "Truly you are the Son of God." But not until our gospel lesson for today has a human being declared Jesus to be the Christ. And it came in response to a question Jesus asked, "But who do you say that I am?" We also have heard the gospel, and by the Holy Spirit's power we confess Jesus, because the true and foundational confession of the church is that Jesus is the Christ. It was at the very limits of what had been Canaan, long before given to the tribe of Dan. Jesus came along with his disciples. Here he would reveal to them that he was the Messiah, the Anointed One of God. The region was populated by Gentiles. Idol worship dominated. And Jesus was concluding his Galilean ministry. The people who heard him speak and saw the miracles had wondered and marveled. And undoubtedly the disciples knew what was being said about their teacher, Jesus. So he asks his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" Jesus uses his own name for himself, Son of Man, because he intends to tell them about his passion. It was generally understood that the Messiah would be a son to God. The answers the disciples reported were not necessarily bad. Although Herod had not seen Jesus, from what he heard, he thought Jesus was John the Baptist, raised back from the grave. The people thought of Jesus as in the line of the prophets of the Old Testament, And there are also hints of the Passion. Elijah and Jeremiah were among those who had suffered. John had been beheaded. As in Jesus' day, many people today think of our Lord only as some important religious figure, or as a kind of guru or teacher, or as an example. But that's not enough. He is the Christ. At his birth, the angels told the shepherds, "For unto you is born this day Christ the Lord." Jesus must be confessed to be the Son of God. Jesus is the Son of God. The disciples needed to know. The mission couldn't move forward unless they confessed him as the Christ. We need to know it and confess it if we are to be saved. Pastor Mark Lest tells this story. As a teenager in the 1970s, I was raised in the Chicago suburbs. Nearby was the world's largest airport, O'Hare International. Each year, our youth group would go there and hand out Christian tracts and witness to people. This was back when you could wander the airport pretty much freely. We always did this on the Sunday after Thanksgiving, the busiest travel day of the year. Most people would take the tracts without comment, although some would politely refuse. There were a lot of people, but I remember one encounter in particular. I had approached a woman offering her a tract saying, "Merry Christmas, God bless you." She stopped, looked at me in disgust and said, "You poor foolish boy, no, I don't want that," and huffed away. I went on not thinking too much about it, but a man came up to me and said, "Do you know who that was?" I had no idea. He said, "That was Madeline Murray O'Hare." I responded, "The owner of the airport?" He laughed, "No, the atheist." And then he said, "Good for you. God bless you." I'd later learned who she was and what she was about. I also learned at a young age that you never know when you'll be given the opportunity to confess Christ or to him. Jesus asks his disciples, "But who do you say that I am?" All along, he was leading up to this question. He wants to know what they think. And Peter boldly replies, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Now, we know Peter's reputation as being kind of impetuous. It was Peter who told Jesus to tell him, to come out of the boat onto the water and to him. Later, during Jesus' passion, Peter refuses to have Jesus wash his feet, but then tells him to wash all of him. Later, he says he will never deny Jesus. But then soon at the high priest's palace, he vehemently denies three times that he ever knew Jesus. There's a bit of Peter in all of us. Thankfully, our Savior is patient with us and invites us to repent and say we love him. The Bible tells us that no one is able to say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. Jesus tells Peter that his confession, made on behalf of the 12, comes by revelation of the Holy Spirit. His words to Peter, "Flesh and blood have not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven," are a great blessing. In the explanation of the third article of the Creed, Martin Luther begins by saying, "I believe that I cannot by my own reason or strength believe in Jesus Christ my Lord or come to him. The Holy Spirit has called me by the gospel." There are many Christians who find this hard to say because by nature we want to do something for or have a part in or take some of the credit for our salvation. But we can. The Holy Spirit must and does do it for all who believe. By the preached word and the sacraments, we have forgiveness and faith in Jesus. By his power, we are able to confess he is the Son of God. this confession, that Jesus, Son of God and Son of Man, is the Christ, is foundational to the building of the church. St. Paul tells us that the church is built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets. It is in the word of Christ that we are rooted and established. Jesus responds to Peter's confession by calling him by his name and reminding him that it means rock. Peter speaks for himself and the apostles. The confession he makes is rock solid. The church is not founded on any person except Jesus Christ. And by this confession that he is the Christ, and by the witness and testimony of the apostles, Jesus builds his church. With Christ, our enemies are overcome. The devil, the world, and our own sinful flesh threaten us constantly. They would have us give up in despair. The unrepentant remain slaves to sin. Christ has come to free us and liberates us. Just as Jesus gathered his first disciples and showed them the way, he also calls, gathers, enlightens, and sanctifies us by his Spirit. He washes, feeds, helps us through life. Flesh and blood have not revealed this to us, but by the ministry of the gospel, we are his, and we live under him in his kingdom. Amen. Now the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. Having heard the word proclaimed, let us pray for ourselves, for all the faithful, and for all people as they have need. For all people, that they may have faith in Christ and heed the voice of God calling by his word. For the church, that the people of God may pursue righteousness with peace and joy in their hearts. And for all pastors in their ministry of word and sacrament, and for all vocations to the ministry, that the lives of God's people may redound to his praise and glory. For our president, Congress, governor, and all civic leaders in their pursuit of peace and unity, for all judges and magistrates in their pursuit of justice with mercy, and for those who protect us from violence and preserve order here and everywhere, for all noble professions, and for the flourishing of the arts and music, for favorable weather and the fruits of the earth, and for those unemployed, the poor, the homeless, the hungry, and all people in need, for all families and children, single adults and youth, for those who teach and those who learn, that they may advance in the wisdom and grace, and for the catechumens and those who teach the faith, for victims of disaster, and for those stricken by illness and infirmity, for the aged and infirm, for those in nursing homes and assisted living facilities, for those who grieve the loss of those whom they love, and for those who meet with sudden death, and especially for those who we name in our hearts before you now. For the work of God's kingdom in this place, for our faithful support of the church and the renewal of our parish life through the means of grace, and for our growth in grace, that we may attain to the full stature of Christ. Be merciful to us, O Lord, and hear our prayers. Grant to us the grace of your Holy Spirit, that we may be led into all truth and be steadfast in the confession of Christ. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Well, thanks so much for joining us again for worship. We're going to continue to stream our services on YouTube and Facebook, and they'll be available on Zoom. Also, if you do feel comfortable joining us in person for an outside worship service for this next month or so, we'll be having worship services outside under a tent, 10 o'clock on Sunday mornings. They will also be available online if you prefer to follow us that way. Blessings.